Okay, turn with me, if you would, to Exodus chapter 15. Excuse me. Exodus 15. And I want to talk about us seeing the church in God's view of her. When I say that, I mean, of course, God's spiritual meaning of the church, but I mean more than that. I mean God's view of this church. According to the scriptures, and according to God's plan. And to really, and I'll be honest with you, I really, I stand before you in fear and trembling because I fear that I'm not going to be able to communicate what I feel in the heart of the Lord in relationship to some of these things. So, just to give you a little background before we look at the scriptures here, in verse 15, or chapter 15 is when Israel has crossed the Red Sea and they've come out to begin their journey, and it is a the first part is a song of Moses or the song of the redeemed. After the destruction of Pharaoh and the chariots and all of that sort of thing. But to just give you a little background before we read it, Israel here in chapter 14, 13, they are called out of Egypt from a certain relationship. I realize that everyone marks Israel coming out of Egypt as salvation for the Christian. I hardly ever hear anybody say anything different. But I believe that there's more to it than that, and here's even why I say that. Long before they were in Egypt, they were the people of God. I mean, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Joseph, I mean, you know, all of them, even Joseph was before Egypt. The 12 sons, the 12 tribes, if you will, were before that. And down there, they believed in the living God, the real God. I mean, am I right? I mean, you know, I know nobody says this, but I'm just trying to make a point here that I, what if the actual Red Sea event was something different than what we made it? The crossing of the Red Sea and beginning on this. What if it was something that actually was supposed to happen in the life of a Christian or the people of God? And so with that in mind, I want to begin to draw a contrast between the people of God before the Red Sea and after the Red Sea. We know that they had to journey on into the land, that God had big plans for them in the promised land. We know God's purposes in many ways, but I feel that the Lord is really having me draw this contrast here. We also know that Abraham and Isaac and Israel, Jacob, who became Israel, were men of God. There were men and women of God. Sarah and Rebecca and Rachel and on and on and on. I mean, men and women of God who knew the Lord and who had a personal relationship with the Lord, and had all of them before the Red Sea met the real God, and not only met him, but were like really, really with him and plugged into him. Serving him, knowing him, believing him, walking with him, hearing from him. I mean, we're talking about some pretty good relationships here before the Red Sea. You know, one reason why Moses is called a deliverer and not a savior is because he didn't save them. God did, if you will. God had already met them and was dealing with them in their lives. And they were already, folks, they were already praying to the real God for what? Deliverance, not salvation, but yes, salvation, yes, yes, salvation from the enemy, but that would be no different salvation than if you had a bad job with a boss and a bunch of people that just messed with you all the time. And you prayed for deliverance. You could say, God save me. Right? I mean, you could say that. But really and truly, it wouldn't be salvation, would it? It would be deliverance from a particular situation, from a particular circumstance, and what have you. And so, this is a, I believe, a big moment for God, for God, because God had Abraham and loved him, and you know, Father Abraham is exalted, you know, you just can't say enough, and Isaac and Jacob, who became Israel. But I believe that this moment of coming out and entering into what a new, I'll just call it that, a new phase, a step up, a furtherance of what was in the heart of God, that God had this plan and he's weaving it all the way through. And so while Israel is just like getting redeemed from Pharaoh and everything, I believe God is moving them towards something that is so in the heart of God, that is just precious to him. And many times around here we talk about, you know, not just knowing, you know, not just praying, oh God, you know, here's what I want, here's my desires, move on my behalf based on me and what I want and based on time and space and right now where I'm at. Excuse me, but trying to find out what God's heart is after. What pleases him? What is important to him? What satisfies him? What are the things so that we, instead of getting him to line up with our lives, we begin to line up with his life. Amen. Amen? I mean, I believe the church would be a lot more successful if we would do that. It's just a thought, you know. But I just think the church as a whole would. And remember, we're talking about God's view of the church, not necessarily the church's view of the church. But God has a thing, a love in his heart, and a thing in his heart that he's after. And it's not just some random thing. It is in direct relationship to the church. It is his heart for her and with her. And so, I'm going to say it like this. I've never heard it said this way before, but I'm just going to do it today. And you know, that Israel was called out of the Egypt of believing God in a personal way, but he was far away from them. But they believed God, but for believing God in a personal way, but he was far away, and entering into a wilderness of hardship, yes, but that God was with them now, and they were now becoming his habitation. Because what did God do almost immediately in the wilderness? When they came out, folks, they were just a gathering of people. A lot of churches are just a gathering of people who believe similar things. But the scriptures tell us that God's desire is that we be built together for a habitation of God. Amen? Built, that we be, there's, you know, the example I've used many times and will continue to use is, if you were going to build a building, this lot was empty, and you were going to build a building out of stones, you came and dumped all of those stones, those living stones, because the scripture calls us living stones, you dumped them there, you would have a gathering, but you wouldn't have a habitation, you wouldn't have a building. Right? And someone could come steal your stones. And you probably would, and not all of them, but they could come take some and you wouldn't even know it. Am I right or wrong? You wouldn't know unless you got them all counted and you're some sort of control freak or something. Maybe some of you would know it. But most of us wouldn't have a clue. However, if those stones were built into a habitation and somebody came and stole a couple of them, you'd notice right off. You'd go, my God, look at this. Somebody came and took some stones out of our building. Right? They were a gathering in Egypt. And when they came out, at first, they were a gathering. They were not built together. They were not built as a habitation. They were the people of God. Right? Just a bunch of stones gathered together, moving together, but nothing like a habitation of God, because before this time, God was far away and visited from time to time. Like he talked with Abraham about the Sodom and Gomorrah thing, and then, you know, but it didn't last long and he was gone soon. This was a breakthrough for the heart of God that he was going to move them out and he was going to begin to build them. And here's the biggest thing, because we say build them, we say, well, he's building us. No, he's building him a habitation. You see what I'm saying? And so that's where his heart is, was to be, now think of this. He goes, he gets to visit Abraham, he shares stuff with Abraham, he visits Isaac, he shares with Isaac. Jacob's running from Esau, he visits him, he shows him stuff. But every time, excuse me, it ends with what? Abraham believing things about God, but God far away. Isaac believing things about God, but God far away. Okay? Right? Does it sound familiar? Maybe even the way some Christians are. But there came a time, excuse me, when God wanted to change, you could say change the order of things, but when we say stuff like that, it all becomes some sort of official plan that God's working, instead of recognizing that God is overjoyed at the Red Sea because he's about to change his dealings with Israel, and he is about to set things up. He's going to set up a camp, and he's going to set up a temple, a tabernacle, a temple where he could live, dwell, the house of God, where he can come down and be in the midst of us, in us. That's big stuff for him. For him. And why? Because it's something he wanted. It's something he cared about. It's something that was just like really, really in his heart. It wasn't just that he's happy going, well, I like sitting on this throne and looking down and going, hey, Abraham, don't do that. You know, Abraham, walk straight. Keep going. Turn left. Good man. You know, I mean, that's kind of the way many Christians have a relationship. He's far away, but he gives instructions, you know. he's leading and guiding, but he's sort of like a dispatcher. You know. He's telling all the trucks where to go and what to deliver and all this kind of stuff. But he's more like a dispatcher than he is, as it were, a husband, a head, the vine, the treasure within the earthen vessel. And so it comes to this time and it comes to this place, and God helped the Holy Spirit to break that part that I've already said, that this was a big deal to God, that this was important, this was in his heart, this was moving into a phase that was so important to him. And so we come to Exodus 15. Let's read the first verse. Then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spoke, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously, the horse and rider hath he thrown into the sea. Anybody ever heard that song? I have not played that song in 100 years. I don't know what key it's in. But I want to see, how many of you think you know that song? Then help me. Yes. I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and rider down into the sea. That's verse one. I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously. The horse and rider thrown into the sea. The Lord my God, my strength, my song, has now become my victory. The Lord my God, my strength, my song, has now become my victory. The Lord is God, and I will praise him, my Father's God. Why did I take the time to do that? Just to make us feel better. No, you know me better than that. I'm not here to make you feel better. But there is this reality, isn't there? Isn't there this wonderful song of the redeemed? Isn't there this glorious dance? But honestly, in their minds, what are they singing about? What are they excited about? Well, just about every ounce of this song is about what God just did to bless them and help them and save them. But when they continue after singing this song, they're still a gathering and not a habitation yet. Do you understand what I just said there? They sang that God did something good for them. And then it was glorious, and God did do something good for him. And it was glorious, amen? So thank God, but that's not the end of it, because he leads them forth from that place onward. Now, they don't know fully, but the most important thing is God knows where he's leading them. It's not a head thing. I'm telling you, I don't believe this thing's a head thing. I don't believe the Father, Son, Holy Spirit sat down before the foundation of the world and said, let's make up people. And then let's make up a plan for them. You know, like you buy a dog and you say, my plan for my dog is he's going to, you know, live in the backyard and he's going to, you know, we're going to walk from time to time and I'll throw him a bone from time to time. Well, that sounds a little like Christianity. No, I'm sorry. No. You know, so there is that this thing that was in his heart that was not in his head. It wasn't just a formulated plan. This was something he was after, and he wanted us to be with him in it. Okay, so we sing this song, but we miss that thing that's in his heart. For example, verse 1 says, then sang Moses and the children of Israel this song unto the Lord, and spoke, saying, I will sing unto the Lord, for he hath triumphed gloriously, the horse and rider hath he thrown into the sea. Pretty cool that they could use all those words right together, huh? Next verse, the Lord is my strength and my song. We sang that, didn't we? And he has become salvation, my victory, is what the way they sing. That's good, huh? Right? He is my God, the Lord my God, my strength, and I will prepare him an habitation for my Father's God, and I will exalt him. Everything is in that song, but this one phrase, I will prepare for him a habitation. Why? And who knew it? I mean, and who knew it? And who even cares? Well, they couldn't fit it into the song. Well, there's got to be better reasons for dropping the heart of God out of a song. I mean, come on. There's got to be better reasons for skipping stuff than, well, it didn't rhyme. we're supposed to know and sing this song gloriously. And you know what? The wonder of this thing is that they're singing about everything God did, but there's that one phrase that says what he's going to do and what they're going to work with him towards. Isn't that cool? Is that cool to anybody? Is it in anybody's mind branded that after we came through the Red Sea, we're here doing one thing. We got one purpose. David said, you know, I want to build a house for God. You know, I got my house, you got yours. It's not right. God, and he, you know, and why would David say such things? Because he had a heart after God, because he knew God's heart. He didn't just know the commandments. He didn't just keep the stipulations, folks. He went beyond keeping. To living, to working, to using his hands and everything, not to keep the commandments or to do the religious thing or the Christian thing or the God thing. But to do the heart thing, the heart of God thing. And look at God, look at God. I have found David, a man after my own heart. You can't hardly get a higher person. And yet, well, forget David. I want to be, you know, I want to be Samson. Strong, but, you know, I can get away with stuff. I mean, I don't know. I'm just, yeah. I'm not good at making this stuff up, but I'm telling you, you know, we can pick any number of people, but David was different in that he didn't want to get away, or he didn't want to do this, or he was really genuinely, his heart was moved that God would have a habitation, because somehow he saw in the wilderness, he saw that when God brought him out, the first thing he started doing is setting the camp in order, so that God could dwell in their midst. For setting the tabernacle or the temple, we are the temple of the living God, setting the temple in order so he could dwell in the midst of that. And this is all David going, you know what? I'm seeing something different here. I'm not just seeing an order or God setting up religious artifacts in a desert. I'm seeing that this, we're starting to strive. You know, David's going, oh my God. God wanted to dwell in us. He wanted to live his life in us. You know Galatians 2:20, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, but not I. Christ lives within me. And do you ever read that from Paul's lips and get the feeling that he likes saying that? You know, I mean, we would go, oh no, I don't want the cross where it's going to kill me. Let it kill Jesus. I mean, that's us, you know. Let the cross kill Jesus, but not me, you know. See, Paul said, not I. Right. We said, let it kill me, not I. But there is that church that is a habitation of God through the Spirit. There is that church that they're primary purpose is that he may live and not I, as Paul said. So let's see. Let's go to Isaiah 66. It's almost at the very end of the book of Isaiah. And just before Jeremiah, Isaiah 66. Now remember that God did all of that because he wanted to be so close in us that we were literally his house. The place where he dwelt, the place where he felt comfortable, the place where he was at home, the place that made room for him pleasantly. Home. Amen? instead of Abraham had a great relation, but God was way up there. God never dwelt in him. God never dwelt in the midst of the family that was there. They had God. They had the beliefs of God. They walked with God. They walked in faith. But they were not a habitation of God. That didn't take place until later. All right, Isaiah 66, let's read verse 1 and 2. Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne, and the earth is my footstool. Where is the house that ye build unto me? And where is the place of my rest? Okay, so get this. This is God almost sounding like, what do you think you're doing building me a house? I mean, if you listen to that, it's almost sounding like, I'm not interested in no house. Doesn't it sort of sound that way? I'm not interested, you know, what? Penny any people, who do you think you are going to build me a house? It sort of sounds that way, doesn't it? And maybe we never read on, and therefore we think, you know, I don't think having a habitation for God is that big a deal after all. But you got to read the Word of God, and you got to look for His heart, not just try to understand Scripture, because the devil quoted Scriptures, and the Pharisees knew it left and right and missed Jesus. We look for Jesus. That's what sets us apart. It's what makes us who we are. Can I get more amens than three? I mean, could every one of you give me at least three amens? You don't believe that. Never mind, I'm kidding. All right, so let's read verse 2. Now, remember, the last part is, where is the house that you build unto me, and where is the place of my rest? What if he's actually asking, where is it?
Yes.
And then he goes in, for all those things, I want you to notice that the word things is in parentheses. Why? Who knows? Because the word things is not in the original. They added that word. You with me? For all those hath mine hand made, and all those things, again, is not in the original, have been, saith the Lord. In other words, up to this time in Isaiah, we built temples, we built houses. Right? But to this man will I look. Oh my goodness, look, the word man is in parentheses too. It's not in the original. He's not talking, the things are not in the original, because he's not talking about things, he's talking about a house, a place of rest that you would build him. Now that's real important. If the person leaving caused you to miss that, you will go to hell. I'm kidding. For all the, we're just joking here. The word things is not things. It's specific. This is very specific what he's saying. It's house. It's what you're going to build for me. It's my place. That's, if you're going to put anything in there, then fill it in with those words, because it's not just random things. It is specifically, he's talking about a house and a place of rest. And he hasn't changed his subject when he goes to the word, but to this will I look. And in the prince, even to him that is poor and of a contrite spirit and trembleth at my word. Folks, he's talking about a place of rest, and he's talking about, you're doing it wrong. You're building me buildings, and I want you to become that, but I want it to be someone who has a broken, contrite heart like David did in relationship to building me, or if you will, becoming my habitation. And trembling at the word, no, not going, you know, let's see if I can do it here. And a portion shall be for the prince on the one side, and on the other, I randomly picked a scripture here from the word just to make a point. And a portion shall be for the prince on the one side, and on the other side of the oblation of the holy portion. And then we step back and go, oh, I tremble at his word. Is anybody getting my point here? we're just randomly trembling at anything, when he's saying that trembles at my word concerning building me a habitation and you be in that building.
That's it.
Like David's heart did. Like David's heart wanted that so much for the Lord that just spent his whole life. When God said you can't build it, what did he do? He spent the rest of his life gathering the materials, still working on it. Why? Well, if God told you you couldn't do something, you'd quit. Well, it's the will of God. God said quit. So I'll leave it to somebody else. It's exactly how we are. Because, and I'm telling you, you know, over and over and over again, God tests us to see if we know his heart. God says to Moses, look, I tell you what, I'll just kill all these people and raise up a whole new generation from you because they're rebellious and everything. And Moses goes, no way, man, this is your people. This is your habitation. This is the place that you build. This, you know, we would say, well, if that's the will of God, make them all like me. Kill them and make everything like me. Glory, this is the Lord. That's the way we would respond. That, you know, the difference between them and us is they knew God.
Yeah.
Or, shall I say it, they knew God's heart. And they could banter with God. And what I mean by that is God could say, David, you can't build a house. And David would say, I know you want a house. And I believe you need a glorious house. And I will spend the rest of my life and all at my expense and everything to gather all the materials so that when the day comes to build it, Solomon will have it all right there. And it'll just go up and we'll go, yeah, God's got a house. Instead of going, well, Solomon, you better get busy, dude. You just became king and you got a real task here gathering some materials, man. You know, since you're the chosen one and God's not letting me do it, well, then you better get to work gathering some stuff. You'll be 90 before you get it all. David wasn't motivated by any of that. He's motivated by one thing, God's heart. He saw what was in God's heart. He knew God wanted a habitation, and he didn't know the answer why he necessarily couldn't be the one to build it. But his heart was still for God, the desire of God, what God wanted, that we become a habitation of God through the Spirit. As Paul said, not I, Christ lives in me. Get it. Catch that. That means you're a habitation. Christ lives in me. He lives in me. He's not just in there. He's living in me. He lives in me. I'm his house. You know, I said this when we were in Ireland. I said, you know what it means to be the house of God? If somebody, before I started this service, and somebody that could speak holy, I don't speak that language very well, but somebody that could speak holy walked up before I shared and said, we are the house of God. Everybody go, oh, yeah. We're the house of God. You know, folks, what does it mean to be the house of God? Well, your part of that is just, you're a house. Oh, what? You're a house. You're his house. You're just the house. He's the inhabitant. I want to be the inhabitant. I know. That's why we preach the cross. And that's why we don't like you preaching the cross. No, sorry. So, in this scripture, we're discovering that there is this, not just any place he wants to dwell. He does want to dwell among us, but he's looking for someone who is broken to their core, trembling, who is contrite. You know what contrite means? You know, have you ever seen a kid that was contrite before he got spanked? What was it? Throwing stuff everywhere. And you whip them good or whatever. Not that we allow that. In case the law is listening. And then they're sitting there and they're broken and contrite. Do you know what that means? They're not living the way they want to anymore. Well, the way to break us is that our hearts are broken toward the Lord's desire to have a house. And from the moment we see it, we set ourselves to build ourselves into one another until Christ lives in us and not us. Not Christianity lives. Christianity lives! Well, I don't know if that's such a jubilant thing or not. I've been out in it. And it's not necessarily that great. But Jesus living in us, now that's good stuff. That'll work. That will work. Hallelujah. So, God is looking. When they come out, He's looking to set them up and to do this. And, you know, think of this. The Almighty God's got the whole globe. He didn't choose to make His abode among the glories of Egypt. Now, just anybody who's any good at Egyptology at all will know, my Lord, they had a priesthood, they had sacrifices, they had glorious temples, they had, think of all the Pharaoh. King Tut just left our city, or Dallas recently, you know? Yeah, not alive, but that's the difference between their king and our king. He lived back then, and ours is still alive. But if you just studied all of the incredible, even of the astrology things in relationship to the pyramids and all of that, they were advanced, but God didn't want to dwell there. He didn't want His glory to do. He couldn't find an abode among all the glory and incredibleness of Egypt. Or if you went to Babylon or any of the great nations that were raised up, He didn't want to dwell there. Those places and people and their temples, they were very attractive to the human eye. But not to God. Not to God. Not to God. So let's just look at the camp. Look at the camp of Israel. They're out in this desert. God sets it in order. Puts it. If you know the order, if you know how they were placed, if you looked at it from above, the camp was in the shape of a cross. A big old cross. Did you know that? And so here they are, the camp is in the desert, and God is in the midst of it. But when you look at it, you see that it was exposed, right, to the elements and to everything around it. It was exposed, it was defenseless, it was not set up based on a military strategy. Well, that's dumb right there. Any of the nations that would have done this before, they would have set up the camp with certain guards and certain things and a perimeter. I was in the army. Anybody know what a perimeter is? You establish a perimeter. I'm telling you that you establish a perimeter. If you don't know anything else militarily, that's one thing you need to know. You establish a perimeter. And it's all based on self-protection. And folks, when we're not going to let Jesus live in us, we're going to self-protect. And we're going to set the camp according to an order that saves us and protects us and keeps us. And we're going to... Do you know that any camp that became like permanent, they would build walls, right? And from the walls, they would shoot down. Folks, anybody that's going to self-protect is going to build walls.
That's right.
But God's camp wasn't that way. It was set up with one purpose, having God in the midst. Isn't that beautiful? I'm telling you, I think that's beautiful. That they just followed God, and they're going, well, we're not very protected out here, and they weren't, and they knew it too. But they said, this is the order for God, for Him to come and dwell in the midst of us, because he'd never done that before, for them to be the habitation of God on earth. And so they said, this is the way we're going to be set up, so that he can do that. It's beautiful. But to do that, they had to be absolutely dependent upon God. They had no visible means of support. Does that scare anybody? My God, the economy! There's no visible means of support. We're going to have to be absolutely dependent on God. I thought all Christians were already that. Gosh, I guess I missed that part. I missed that conference. But here is Israel, and this camp, this place, this is God's chosen habitation. The only problem is it's set down in the middle of a desert. Not glorious like Babylon or Egypt or any of those other places. Not glorious outwardly, just glorious for what it stands for. We need to know the spiritual purpose and definition of the church. We need to understand who we are in this place in God's eyes. I'm telling you. But here they are. So in spite of weakness and their own failures, because they had plenty in the wilderness. Didn't they have plenty of failures in the wilderness? Everybody blew the chili at some time or another. In spite of all the strife that was within the camp. Oh no, this can't be of God. It can be his house. In spite of all of the attacks from other nations outwardly that tried to destroy him, in spite of all of that, there was one striking fact. God had a habitation in the wilderness. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. Incredible. Turn with me to the book of Acts real quick. Acts chapter 7. Acts 7, and we're going to look at verse 37. Again, I'm going to try to point out something here from this scripture. But while you're turning there, the only claim to fame, the only claim to fame for Israel was that they let God, through his life, live in them. That's all they had. That doesn't sound like much. So other than fulfilling the deepest desire of God's heart, they seemed unimportant. Well, maybe we seem unimportant. I don't know. But other than fulfilling the heart of God and his desires and living to that end, that's all you got. I hope it's enough, you know. Acts chapter 7, verse, what did I say, 37 and 38. And this is that Moses who said unto the children of Israel, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren like me. Him shall you hear. Now I want you to notice something. Moses is speaking this, and he's not explaining himself. He's explaining the definition of the one that's going to come. Okay, so you got to catch that. Don't mix the words up here with Moses. He's saying he is like me, and so in like manner as I was this, so he is. Do you get what I just said? He's talking about the one who's coming. That's why it's even being quoted here. He's not talking about himself, but everything he says about himself, this, he's like me in that he's this way. Okay? So let's read it again. This is that Moses who said unto the children of Israel, here's the quote, a prophet shall the Lord your God raise up unto you of your brethren, like me, him shall you hear. This is he that was in the church in the wilderness. Okay, just don't read further now. This is he that was in, it's still talking about Moses, but it's saying he's like, God's raising up one like unto me. Well, first of all, the church wasn't in the wilderness. Why would it say the church in the wilderness? Come on, just run your mind a little bit through theology you come up with. Because it was a representation of the church in the wilderness, and the fact that this is he that was in the church in the wilderness. In it. Moses was in that tabernacle all the time serving God, but it represented the one who was going to come. Moses didn't represent Moses. He represented Jesus in the temple and in the midst, and the one who spoke the word, and everybody said, let's go, and you're the head, and you're the life of us, and you're the...
Amen.
That's what it's saying. I'm not making that up. It's really there, and it's plain. You know, for he that hath a heart to see. And here's the only reason why I said it like that. Because our eyes miss stuff that our heart will catch from the Lord.
Amen.
But when we know his heart, you'll see a lot of stuff that others just skip right on over. So, here they are. They're strung out, laid out in order, but they're in this dry, thirsty land. They're in this wilderness. What about the rest of the world? Glories of Egypt. What about other parts? Glories in different parts of the world. All of this kind of stuff. Most of the nations of the world knew nothing, cared nothing, thought nothing about this assembly. Cared, it never came to their mind. Wasn't a big deal. If you asked them where the importance was, they would point somewhere else. God would point right there in that dry place and say, right there in that desert, that's what's important. But they didn't know anything about it. They didn't care anything about it. Their thoughts never went to that assembly out there in the desert. Man, and you can be sure too, you can be sure that that desert that they were surrounded by, it never, I mean, it gave them absolutely nothing. It made life nothing but hard. Is anybody getting something beyond just spiritual truths floating around? Please. It was, that wilderness drained them, and it refused to sustain them. It fought against their being sustained. But God sustained. God sustained. And that wilderness that they were in, even though that was the spot for God, this is the only place I've ever been able to come down and have a house, have a habitation, a dwelling place. That wilderness sent scorpions. It sent snakes, and it sent desolation and drought, and it sent heat, and all of those things beat on those people. You better know it. I mean, you think it's hot here, folks. It's, let's see. In Iraq, many of the days are 120 degrees. Okay, well, that's true of Saudi Arabia, too, which, by the way, is where the wilderness was. It's all in the same area. 120 degrees in a tent. I mean, I can see most of you standing at the door shaking, trying to get the wind to circulate inside that tent, you know. I mean, it was not easy. Oh, if it's the Lord, it's all going to be easy. It's all going to be fun. Well, you know, maybe I thought that 20 years, no, however long, it's almost been 30 years now. 30 years ago on Bolivar, and looked like it. Now I look like I've been beat with the ugly stick. Because it's not all fun. This world, it drains you, it attacks you, it beats you. What do you have to stand on? We are a habitation, and we will be that. We will fulfill his desire in this earth. And with all of that oppression, with all of that hardness, with all of that difficulty, there was to God that wonderful assembly. I got goosebumps all over me. Because that's what it was to him. That wonderful assembly maintained in a manner that confused and baffled human reason. All the great nations that came and fought against him just didn't make sense. And it doesn't, and it won't. You're just another dot on the map if you're not looking to fulfill the heart desires of the Lord. Israel, folks, was not of the desert. They were just passing through it. But they were a habitation and would be forever. To live towards that end, that Christ may live in me, not me, not my reactions, not my attitudes, not, you know. That's eternal. We are his body. Folks, what does it mean that he's head and body? Well, we separate that into something. Folks, the body is united to the head. And all that is true of the head and all the thoughts and all of the reflexes and all of the whatever, you know, flows down into that body. But he's not just the head, folks. He is the contents of the body. We have this treasure in earthen vessels. The one thing that the church continues to miss, they make him head, but that just means boss. There is no unified to him so that all that he is flows into us. But he's the contents. He is the treasure so that the power will not be of us. And yet, the church continues to be Christians gathered in a heap, no building, no habitation, no consider. David hadn't showed up for him yet. Can I get an amen? David hadn't showed up for him. All they know is let's pray to God and let's do some offerings and let's do some things. And every once in a while he'll show up in our service. But then it goes back to us doing the best we can for God. There's more to it than that. There is more to it than that. If that's it, I'm going to find me another religion. That's not much. That's, you know, offering that. And expecting me to go, oh, yay, you know. Folks, Christ in you is the hope of glory. Not Christ in heaven, not Christ in the clouds, not Christ walking around in our church service. In us. We start voiding out Jesus and moving him further away and further and further and further and further and further. Instead of fulfilling his heart and getting him closer and closer and in us and in our midst. And he's in our camp. Now he's in our temple. Now he's, you see what I mean? This glorious thing. And that's what I said. We got to see this thing from God's point of view. Why? What? The eternal situation is God's eye ever rested on Israel. I mean, any moment, any hard time, his heart rested, his eyes rested on his. He never took his eyes away. What's going on over here in Egypt? I don't care. What's going on over here in Babylon? I don't care. This is where my eyes rest. It says that in the scriptures, folks. His presence was there. He dwelt there. It was there that he found a habitation. Let's look in Psalms. This will be my first ending here. Psalms 107. Psalm 107, the last part, beginning with verse 31. If you know Psalm 107, it has different scenarios. And it always ends with, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and his wonderful works to the children of men. So let's start at that one. And we won't read all the way down. We'll start there. Verse 31, Psalm 107, verse 31. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Let them exalt him also in the congregation of the people. Do you hear what that's saying? Let them exalt him. They're not just saying let them exalt God. They're saying let him be exalted in the temple, in the habitation. Let him be exalted to have a habitation. I mean, it says that. He turneth, verse 33, he turneth rivers into a wilderness and the water springs into dry ground, a fruitful land into barrenness for the wickedness of those who dwell therein. Then verse 35, which is what he did in the wilderness. He turneth the wilderness into a pool of water and dry ground into water springs. And there he maketh the hungry to dwell, that they may prepare a city for habitation. This was his heart. This was why he delivered them. Did you hear what I said? He didn't deliver them so that all, you know, everybody, what's it say in Matthew 1:1. And so-and-so was born, and so-and-so had children, got married, had children, and died, and so-and-so. I mean, it says that a lot of the genealogies are just like that, you know, in the Old Testament. And they begot so-and-so. And so-and-so lived, and he married so-and-so, and he begot children, and he died. So you could add to that a little bit. As so-and-so grew up, was begotten, grew up, got married, bought a house, bought a microwave, got transportation, had children, lived, and they died. And then their children got married, bought a house, bought microwaves, transportation, and then had children, they died. And they lived, got married, got a house, got another microwave, got transportation, had children, and they died. This is, folks, it scares me to read stuff like that. It's right here in the Bible to read that and go, may my life serve something greater than myself. And even great, not just go, let's go take the world. Hey, let's let the Lord take us. You know, I mean, people are going, God inhabits the praises of his people. Yeah, but he doesn't inhabit his people. You know, let him have a little more than just your praise. Praise God. Now get in there. Is that it? How about get in us? How about overtake me like Mary? Overshadow me until your life comes out of me. I mean, that was glorious to God. It didn't, you know what? It didn't say that. It said, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so begat, so-and-so of whom was Mary who brought forth Jesus. It didn't just say she begat so-and-so and that died. That's it. That was it. It's all over with. No, my God, somebody became a habitation of God and came forth out of them. And that God marked it. It's a big deal today. You know, big deal, you know. And I don't know that the angels got it. They wish to look into these things. They don't understand habitation. God doesn't live in angels. You say, well, angels, I don't know why God would have it. You know, what is man that thou art mindful of us? I mean, the angels, they perfectly obey you. They do everything you want in the right spirit, in the right way. They never sin. I don't always perfectly obey you. I sin. Why would you say, you know, why not just get rid of us and keep angels? And he says, because they're not a habitation. You can become that. You can. can become a habitation. Christ can live his life through you. And no angel, no matter how good and how much they got you beat, because God's greater desire is not perfect obedience and sinlessness, it's that he could live in you. I'm not discounting sin or all that. I'm just saying, clearly from that, there's a higher thing. Amen. Let's stand together. I don't know. I have I detected from Ben's words today while he was leading worship something similar to what I've been going through now for several months. And God is just getting me in a position where I really don't care about anything except seeking him in a true heart desire, to the point that I would be willing to just grab those that I know really have this desire we talked about right here and just say, hey, come with me, let's go hide out, and we're going to just seek this Jesus that we love so much. I mean, I just, you know, it's like, the heck with religion. Let's find Jesus, but not the way evangelists or everyone tells us, but the way that the Spirit is drawing our heart towards the Lord. John said, he must increase and I must decrease. That way. Not more preaching, not more souls, more of Jesus. And I just have a feeling that there are others, and I can't put it into words either. But everything within my being is just travailing towards this. Everything in my being to this point. May the Lord keep dealing, and may we take steps that will help facilitate that until he just overshadows all of me. You know? For some of you, maybe you just have early tinges of that. But all I know is I'm not sensing my desires. I'm sensing God's desires. And I just don't want to miss it or mess up or fool around. I'm serious with the Lord. And at whatever cost that means, I'm ready to go. I'm so ready. I'm just ready. But I know it's going to take more seeking and on our face and letting the Spirit of God lift up Christ instead of lifting up gifts. Because Jesus said when he comes, he'll talk about me to you and reveal me. And I want Jesus' purpose, what he said. Father, we just ask you. Father, I don't even think any of us really know what we need to ask. Father, I just don't. I think the closest thing we can come to is whatever your desires are, work those desires in our hearts so that we're with you in it and we are your bride, your help, fit for you to accomplish this end. That a bride is the home of the Lord. It's not the house that the husband comes home to. It's the bride. Father, just like the Lord said, who is going to build for me what I want? Here's what I'm looking for. Those who tremble at my word of habitation. Those that are contrite and broken, and they're in a position not to fight anymore, but they're willing to decrease so that the Son can come forth. Lord, we hear your words. Let us hear your heart. Lord, impact us. Impact us. Slam into us. Don't let us just be another name in a long line of genealogies. But may it be said that we allowed Christ to be formed in us and to come forth out of us. Father, move by your Spirit. Lord, bless tonight the lack of time together, that for those that will have that time and want to, they can open their heart and seek in you a little more. Lord, even a short prayer, anything in your direction. You said, if we will draw near to you, you will draw near to us. Anything we do in your direction cannot be negative, but will be positive. Lord, it's easy to bow our heads or to come to an altar call in church. Help us to come to your altar during some television show or during some other thing going on. Even if in our heart alone, even if our heart is saying, oh Jesus, I really do want you and I don't want to waste my time on this planet missing you. Father, we put it in your hands. We are too weak and too frail to even know what to say or do. We just say we want you. Move. Hear our hearts. More than that, put your heart in us. In Jesus' name. Father, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Lord, if our numbers be but small that have this heart, gather more into us. Even of those who are gathered here, gather more into that heart. That the building may be even bigger, the habitation, your house may be even bigger, more room for you to dwell. In Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Why don't you just, if you want to make an altar right where you are, feel free to do that. If not, go ahead and greet one another. Go find somebody.